most people, when they think of Morris dancing, they just see sort of 50-something bearded old men, and they don't really associate it with younger dancers. But it's not always been like that, because these are people who started when they were my age at university, 18, 19 or whatever, in the Morris revival of the 70s. And it's just there's not been sort of a resurgence since then. So they were just turned into the old men that they were following on from when they started dancing. How did I get into Morris dancing? It's something I get asked quite a lot. I've always been into folk music. And then about 4 years ago, I went with my dad to the Wath Fire Festival and just saw the side dancing outside the church doing a border. And it just struck a chord within me that day. But that was it was the Morris on band that I saw. That was the first introduction to Morris music. And that was this glorious day at this folk festival I'd been to. It was camping, and it had been raining for the whole weekend, and it was absolutely awful. Everyone was in a bad mood. And then the Morris on band came on, and as soon as they started, they got Morris dancing out on the stage, and the sun just came out. It was a beautiful day, and everyone was just dancing around. And I think something changes when you reach drinking age, and you can go out and you can get drunk, and you can wear a stupid costume and dance around. There's a few roles that there are traditionally upheld in the Morris side. There's a squire, there's a bagman, and there's a foreman. The foreman teaches dancing at practices. The bagman's sort of the secretary, and he's in charge of everything that happens that's not on a dance out. And the squire's role is, apart from being the figurehead, is to tell everyone what to do on a dance out. And that's easier said than done, because the Morris team is a law unto itself, really. And no matter what you say, they'll do the opposite. They'll do what they want. So I don't think it's anything to do with my age, which undermines my authority. I just think it's their resolute.
Some foolery.
Yeah, they'll do whatever you don't want them to do. But being the youngest, I think it probably has its downsides more than anything, because it means I have to dance every dance, because they assume I've got infinite energy. I can just keep going all day. Morris dance, it's sort of basically split up into border and Cotswold. Border's the stuff that you see where they wear raggy jackets and paint their faces black and scream a lot. That's sort of from the Welsh borders. And then Cotswold dancing is where you've got the handkerchiefs and dressed all in white. That's from like a cluster of little towns around Gloucestershire, that sort of area. And each of these villages had a tradition, and all the sides sort of pick a tradition which they like and dance that. Now there are a few sides which they've still kept dancing, like Bampton, Adenbury and Abingdon. And I was lucky enough to get and dance in all these towns in my first year. Met a lot of the big names of the Morris world, if you will. The reason I've seen for a jig to be danced is that it gives the rest of the team a chance to have a rest between the set, especially if you stretch and you've only got like a 6 or 7 men on a dance act. One of you does a jig, it gives you the rest of the side of town chance to have a rest. But Burke says, who teaches our side in his book, Morris Jigs from Bleddington, Headington, Lumber and Bucknell, that it has long been my contention that the Morris Jigs are underused. They offer excellent opportunities for individual dancers to improve their confidence and technique, so that ultimately the performance level of the whole side is raised, and they are also of considerable value in shows. That's what Burke says. I suppose there's clear health benefits in that it's a good regular exercise, gets you out in the fresh air. And Bert, he's still dancing at 77, but I saw a guy of 40 drop down dead dancing it, so I think they'd extol the virtues of Morris dancing as a healthy activity.
Being the youngest member, you never really get to dance with people your own age. I mean, most sides, they've got one young member, but they never really come together enough to form one side. I mean, the Morris ring, which sort of resides over the, all the Morris teams in the country, they have an 18 to 30 club, and every year a group of younger Morris dancers get together in a one city somewhere and have a weekend of dance. I know Huddersfield, based side, White Rose, they had so many young dancers that they set up their own breakaway group called Dog Rose, and they've been pretty successful up and down the country with that. But it's something, yeah, so I'd like to try and set one up in Sheffield. I've got a couple of people interested. They're going to come down, teach them a few jigs, and see how it goes from there. Teaching him ladies of pleasure, that's, I suppose technically it's one of the most difficult ones because it's got lots of shuffles and lots of hocklebacks, and shuffles are seen as sort of being the most difficult step in Morris dancing, and hocklebacks are just tricky because you're basically trying to trip yourself up with every step and jump out of it at the same time. Favourite jig's probably Jockey to the Fair, but I think it's also the hardest one that you can do as well. It's got like 8 straight capers in a row, which is pretty tiring.
I can do it!
As far as future plans goes, I've been the Squire of Wath for, this is the start of my second season, so after this I'll be up for, or someone else will be up for election, or I'll be up for re-election. I'm not sure whether I'm going to stay a squire or let someone else have a go.
This is it, and that is it, and this is Morris dancing. The piper fell and he broke his neck, and he said it was a chancer.